Oh, there's no doubt about it. The golden age began in 1944 when the about-to-be victors of the Second World War realized that the 1930s depression, the Smoot-Hawley Act with tariffs, had led, and then the Second World War had led to the kind of chaos that they had sought, and that the world had to cooperate. The collective action was the only way in which they're going to deal with issues. They set up the multilateral institutions, and we went through probably the longest period of economic growth that we've ever seen. And there is no doubt that the challenges to the multilateral institutions, the challenges to cooperation, the challenge to collective action is really the most backward-looking thing I think that we have seen in a very long time.
So in that context, and as somebody who helped create the G20, we now have this world power in the form of President Trump, who is really regressive on this stuff, on tariffs, on trade, on multilateral action. What would you do if you were a leader in that room today? How do you fight against that force?
Well, I think that it's going to be a very public fight, because in fact, when somebody appeals to their own nation to say that we will be better off if we don't cooperate, we will be better off if we're perpetually creating this kind of chaos, then all you really have to look at the numbers. And the numbers demonstrate unequivocally that in fact the loss of momentum in the global economy, which has got everybody worried at the present time, is a direct result of the world failing to work together. And that's really been the outcome of the American position.
One thing that's characterized Canada is we have played an outsized role relative to our size for a long time now. We are suddenly being pushed around. Our biggest and best ally is pushing us around. China is pushing us around. What can we do?
Well, I think that we can show the kind of leadership that we showed when the G20 was created. As a matter of fact, we can say, listen, the fact is that we have to cooperate and we have to share sovereignty if we want to protect sovereignty. In other words, globalization is not a government choice. Government choice is a reality. You're not going to fight climate change if you think you can do it within the borders of your own country. You're not going to fight for clean oceans if in fact you think that you're only going to have to do it in the waters that hit your country. So you've got to take a leadership in terms of how do you build cooperation between countries. And I can give you an example of what Canada is doing at the present time. That, you know, Jim Carr, who is the Minister of Trade, is fighting very strongly for what is probably one of the most important issues out there, and that is the fact that the WTO has lost its dispute settlement mechanism because the Americans will not cooperate. They won't name people. And so what Carr has done on behalf of Canada, but on behalf of the rest of the world, is to say we need an alternative mechanism. And that alternative mechanism is, in fact, Canada and the EU. Mm-hmm. And I think what you're going to see is a lot of pressure to expand that. And if the WTO has an alternative mechanism that works, as opposed to the one that at the present time does not work, then I think what you're going to find is the ability of a country like the United States to bring the world to a halt is really going to find a legitimate alternative.
You know, one of the problems that Canada has, of course, is while we deal with trade war tensions, the fallout from tariffs, we are still in this position of being energy dependent and yet trying to pivot away, trying to meet climate change obligations. Can you give me a sense of your thinking of how we're balancing? We've come to think of it as pipelines versus climate change. It's overly simplistic, but there's an economic reality here. Are we walking the right line?
I believe that we have natural resources. We're not going to turn our backs on those, but there is no doubt that the way in which we create energy, the way in which we motor our economies over the years is going to have to change if, in fact, that we're going to live up to the 1.5 degree recommendation that's come from the United Nations, and we're going to have to do that. What does that mean? Well, it means alternative energies over a long period of time. Over a a much shorter period of time. And there's no reason that Canada cannot be leading in these areas. And what we should really be doing is to say that the monies that are coming from a great deal of our own natural resources, the profits from that should be going into the development of these alternative energies over time.
But meantime, I mean, you know better than anybody as finance minister, the value of not just the revenue, current revenue potential of our energy sector, but the lost foreign direct investment we face, the lost capital investment that we face. Do we need to be, does the government need to be pushing harder on pipelines, on action on the energy file today than it is?
Well, what we've got to make sure is that, in fact, when there's a decision that's taken on the pipeline, as an example, that decision takes into account the environmental assessment. And that was the problem that existed. The previous government, and I don't want to be political here, but the previous government essentially made a farce out of the environmental assessment, and that's why we got ourselves into this particular difficulty. And what you've got to do is be open and honest. And there is, we do have huge energy resources, but we've also got to understand that as these generate the jobs, as these generate the profits, that we've also got to become a leader in renewables.
We have seen some progress on including First Nations in the conversation in a better way. What do we need to do? And this is specific for a moment to the energy file, to getting agreement on pipelines, agreement on energy projects. Are we in the right place on this one?
Well, I think that the First Nations have begun to take a leadership in this. Not that we gave it to them. They have taken that leadership, and that is a wonderful thing to see. And I really do believe that when you think about it, the First Nations are the only body that we know that has a cultural base which says we are part of nature. We're not above nature. We can't dictate to nature. And I think to have the First Nations playing an important role in this is really a step forward.
We've seen other steps forward, right? We've seen movement on reconciliation. We've seen additional promises of investment on reserve. And yet, what kind of progress are we making? I mean, we have boil water advisories today in our country. How well are we doing here?
Have we put the money in that should have been put in? Absolutely not. In terms of health care, in terms of education, there's no doubt that our record in this area is not one in which we can be very, very proud. Except that what's now happening is that the First Nations, the Métis and the Inuit, are also playing a leadership role. And when they're at the table basically saying, listen, we understand these issues, but we will run our own education, we will run our own health care, and we are going to do it according to our standards, then you begin to see real success. I mean, I spend now, you know, most of my time in the issue of Indigenous education, Indigenous health. And I can tell you that what we're in the process of doing as an organization, our foundation, is to essentially say we will co-develop these in partnership with the First Nations. And they are coming forth and taking the leadership role. And it is a wonderful thing to see. And I can tell you, it's making a difference.